The dedicated infrastructure and architecture for near-Earth astronautics, or DIANA for short, is an autonomously deployable lunar-based concept for a long-duration crewed mission on the Moon's surface. Robots will construct the base near Dergelash Crater Ridge at the lunar south pole, with a planned arrival of 4 astronauts in 2030. DIANA will facilitate scientific operations and local sorties for both human and robotic exploration, while its self-sustainability will grow over time. Transported in a compact form, the base will autonomously expand into a habitable volume after reaching the lunar surface. This multi-level facility will cater to all habitation needs, featuring private and communal spaces, technical support systems, and a greenhouse for food production. The authors of this deployable lunar base are a diverse team of students from universities in Germany, Austria, Poland, Romania, Spain, and the University of North Dakota. They developed their DIANA plan during a 9-day space station design workshop hosted by the Institute of Space Systems at the University of Stuttgart in 2022. The workshop aimed to create a platform enabling scientific operations and exploration sorties on the Moon, with a strong emphasis on integrating in-situ resource utilization to maximize the use of local resources. The plan's abstract and a detailed PDF document are available in the video description. The name DIANA, inspired by the Roman goddess of the Moon and crossroads to different worlds, aptly reflects the base's role as a pioneering permanent lunar outpost. In this video, we will explore the subsystems critical to establishing and operating DIANA, but first, let's examine the chosen location and the reasons behind its selection. Location: Dergelash Crater. The DIANA team evaluated multiple sites at the lunar north and south poles before selecting the rim of Dergelash Crater near the lunar south pole as the optimum location. This site offers near-constant sunlight with illumination for 86% of the year, making it ideal for solar power generation and reducing reliance on backup systems to just a few weeks annually. Additionally, the proximity to permanently shadowed craters suspected to contain water ice supports in-situ resource utilization for water and oxygen production. The terrain at Dergelash Crater is nearly flat, with an average slope of just over 1 degree, providing a stable foundation for constructing the base. Temperature fluctuations ranging from 59 Kelvin to 244 Kelvin are manageable with an effective thermal regulation system, ensuring a habitable environment for the crew. Building the DIANA lunar base. The DIANA plan outlines the transportation of habitat modules and crew to the lunar surface, but recent advancements have outpaced some of its assumptions. Modern launch vehicles such as SpaceX's Starship and Blue Origin's now operational New Glenn, along with larger lunar landers like Blue Origin's Mark II and Europe's Argonaut, offer improved capabilities. The plan notes Starship as a future option to reduce costs. A key feature of the base is its ability to refuel landers with liquid oxygen produced through in-situ resource utilization systems, improving self-sustainability. Launches are scheduled to begin in 2027, with a goal of achieving full self-sufficiency by 2045. The plan includes the Lunar Gateway as a logistical outpost, but with the US administration considering defunding this project, DIANA's planners may need to revise their strategy to accommodate alternative orbital infrastructure or direct lunar transfers. The DIANA lunar base will be established through 4 carefully planned phases, transitioning from initial setup to full self-sustainability by 2045. Each phase builds on the previous, expanding infrastructure, crew capacity, and scientific capabilities. Phase 1, Equipment Arrival, 2027 to 2030. This phase lays the foundation for DIANA. A communications relay satellite will be deployed in low lunar orbit to ensure reliable Earth-Moon communication. Rovers and power generators will land on the lunar surface, followed by robotic systems that prepare the site for inflatable habitat modules. Mission rovers and the critical life support equipment will then be delivered. By the end of 2030, the first crew of 4 astronauts will arrive, marking the start of a permanent human presence on the Moon. Phase 2, Base Stabilization, crew size 2 to 6. In this phase, DIANA will enhance its self-sustainability. An in-situ resource utilization refinery will be installed to extract and process local resources, such as water ice, reducing reliance on Earth supplies. A radio telescope array will be deployed, enabling initial scientific research. Rovers will conduct exploratory missions, laying the groundwork for broader scientific operations. Phase 3, nominal operations, crew size 7 to 12. Scientific activities will ramp up as additional radio telescope arrays arrive, allowing observations of the universe to begin. Rovers and extravehicular activities will expand research efforts. By the end of this phase, 4 new habitat modules will be delivered and integrated, increasing the base's capacity and functionality. Phase 4, expansion, crew size 18+. With self-sustainability achieved, Diana will expand using local sourced materials, significantly reducing the need for resupply missions from Earth. The base will grow to accommodate a larger crew, including traditional astronauts and potential space tourists, further diversifying its operations and reducing costs. Final base configuration. Upon completion, Diana will comprise 5 key areas. A solar park, generating electrical power for the settlement, including habitats and ISRU equipment. Radiators, dissipating excess heat to maintain optimal temperatures. A landing site, located on a plateau away from habitats, it supports supply missions and lander refueling with ISRU-produced propellants. An astrophysics valley, conducts universe observations delivering valuable scientific data, and a receiver station, facilitating communication with Earth, ensuring robust data exchange. Diana modules. The Diana lunar base consists of 4 distinct modules: a multipurpose laboratory, a window module, a social module, and a greenhouse. Each module serves a unique purpose and features a specific design, arranged in a cruciform layout with 3 nodes connecting them. The primary node houses the main airlock, supplemented by 2 emergency airlocks for safety. Connectors integrated during the initial phase enable future expansion of the base. Inflatable habitat technology. Drawing inspiration from Bigelow Aerospace's inflatable habitats, the Diana team adopted a hybrid design featuring a rigid central core surrounded by an inflatable exterior shell. Although Bigelow is no longer operational, other companies, including Lockheed Martin, Redwire, and Sierra Space, are advancing similar technologies. Notably, NASA recently partnered with Sierra Space to explore inflatable modules for lunar applications, including their use as connectors between habitats. The inflatable modules are compactly folded for launch, significantly reducing volume. Modern heavy-lift launchers such as Blue Origin's New Glenn with a 7-meter fairing diameter and SpaceX's Starship with an 8.5-meter fairing diameter accommodate these designs. In their stowed configuration, the inflatable shell is compressed around the rigid core, limiting the core's diameter to approximately 3 to 4 meters for New Glenn and 4 to 5 meters for Starship. Once deployed, the habitats expand to over 6 meters in diameter for New Glenn payloads and over 8 meters for Starship, providing ample habitation space. Module structure and layout. The rigid core, constructed from aluminium 7075T6 alloy, includes telescopic pillars, foldable beams, a crown, and a bottom base. During deployment, the inflatable shell unfolds to create a spacious interior. Movable panels are placed atop stretched beams to form multiple floors and ceilings, which can be subdivided with wall panels to create private and communal areas. Radiation and environmental protection. To shield against cosmic radiation, solar flares, micrometeoroids, and extreme temperature swings, a 1.6 meter thick 3D printed regolith layer encases the modules. This shield, built using lunar soil, also improves thermal insulation, stabilizing the habitat's interior environment. For additional safety during high radiation events, a safe haven in the lower level of the social module features bilayer shielding, 1.2 meters of regolith combined with 0.6 meters of polyethylene. This configuration effectively blocks both high and low energy particles, offering superior protection compared to regolith alone. Specialized window module. Recognizing the psychological importance of natural light for long duration missions, the team included a window module. Enclosed spaces without exterior views can harm astronaut morale and mental health. The window, made of transparent polycarbonate, similar to that used on the International Space Station, is designed to withstand micrometeoroid impacts of up to 0.5 centimeters in diameter at 70 kilometers per second. Its substantial thickness, providing robust radiation protection, results in a mass of approximately 868 kilos. Despite the weight, the team deemed the window essential for crew well-being. DOORS and micrometeoroid protection. DOORS, which cannot be covered with regolith, use a mesh double bumper shield made of aluminium, Kevlar, and a rear aluminium wall. This lightweight design, weighing 90 kilos per door, is operable with electric actuators, ensuring accessibility and safety. The electric power system. The Diana lunar base relies on a robust electrical power system with a regenerative fuel cell for continuous energy supply, particularly during the lunar night. The system employs advanced triple junction solar cells, boasting a 30% efficiency at the start of operations. These cells generate 175 kilowatts of power, including a 20% margin to meet the base's demands. Due to the low solar elevation at the lunar south pole, the panels are delivered flat and unfurled vertically. Each panel, equipped with a drive mechanism, tracks the sun to maximize energy capture and is spaced to avoid shading, ensuring optimal performance. To power the base during the two-week lunar night, when temperatures plunge below minus 150 degrees Celsius, a regenerative fuel cell serves as a backup. During the lunar day, surplus solar energy powers an electrolysis process, splitting water into hydrogen and oxygen, which are stored in redundant liquefied tanks. At night, the fuel cell reverses this process, recombining hydrogen and oxygen to produce electricity. Initially, 8,000 kilos of water must be transported from Earth to provide sufficient storage capacity, with additional water needed periodically to compensate for reduced electrolysis rates as the solar panels degrade. Thermal control system. The thermal control system ensures that all units, equipment, parts, and components stay within their design temperature ranges throughout their mission lifetime. This is not easy given the wide swings in temperatures experienced during the lunar day-night cycle. The base modules are sunk about halfway into the ground and so benefit from the relative insensitivity of the lunar regolith to temperature swings. Astronauts can control the air temperature inside the habitat to between 19 and 25 degrees Celsius. A water-driven heat exchanger is used to regulate the air temperature within the habitats. Heat loss is quite low and internal heat dissipation is enough to keep the station warm. Two water loops operating at 3 degrees and 21 degrees Celsius manage cooling by transferring heat to external heat exchangers. A small 1 kilowatt electrical heater is included in case of low heat dissipation in the station. The radiator area needed for cooling is expected to be 520 square meters. Overall heat rejection capability is 130 kilowatts. Life support system. In phase one, a life support system will be delivered to the base. Over time, it will progress towards a biologically closed loop system through the implementation of a greenhouse for food production and an in-situ resource utilization for water and oxygen harvesting. A modular bioreactor enhances the system by incorporating water recovery and waste processing. The system also includes trace contaminant control, temperature regulation, and humidity management for a stable environment. Drawing from the European Space Agency's advanced closed-loop system used on the International Space Station, the setup actively removes excess carbon dioxide from the air. The bioreactor, containing Cholera vulgaris algae, converts the carbon dioxide into oxygen and edible biomass. Chemical carbon dioxide scrubbers serve as a backup in case the bioreactor fails. The system generates approximately 530 kilos of methane annually, which is stored and repurposed to refuel landers. In later phases, an upgraded greenhouse module increases oxygen, food, and clean water production through evaporation. Covered by a regolith shield, the greenhouse relies on artificial lighting to sustain plant growth. A greenhouse with growing plants will provide an important psychological benefit to the crew. ISRU, or In-Situ Resource Utilization. ISRU plays a critical role in supporting astronauts by providing life support resources and construction materials, increasing self-sufficiency and long-term cost savings. Autonomous rovers collect lunar regolith, which is filtered and processed into materials suitable for 3D printing. a deployable arm on the 3D printer extrudes the process regolith, shaping it into robust structures. To secure a water supply, the base extracts lunar water ice from nearby craters. Rovers prospect potential sites where viable deposits are confirmed. They drill and transport the ice-rich regolith to processing units. Given the expected 20 kilometers or greater distance between the settlement and water sources, autonomous water recovery operates near excavation sites. Initial robotic systems land directly in craters, excavating beneath the surface for water ice. If a sample contains over 60% water, rovers begin digging, transferring materials to a checkpoint for loading onto transport rovers. Specialized rovers designed to navigate steep crater slopes ensure efficient regolith collection. At a water preparation station, extracted ice is loaded into a 4-meter diameter heating chamber. From 15,400 kilos of material, the system produces 6,000 liters of water, sufficient for a year's supply with margins. The water undergoes filtration to remove contaminants before being piped into storage tanks for integration into the life support system or electrolysis units. Electrolysis splits the water into hydrogen and oxygen, which are stored in tanks to supply the base with breathable oxygen or to refuel landers. As the base grows, the water management system can expand with additional heating chambers and more rovers to accelerate production. Analysis of the regolith may also reveal carbon deposits, which could be processed into methane to refuel landers like Starship, further enhancing resource efficiency. Communication system. The communication system ensures reliable connectivity for the lunar base through a low lunar orbit satellite constellation. A constellation of six satellites operates in a stable elliptical orbit with an 86 degree inclination, passing as close as 720 kilometers to the lunar surface. This configuration guarantees redundancy with at least two satellites always in view from the base, ensuring uninterrupted communication. Two 1.5-meter parabolic high-gain antennas, positioned close to the base, ensure robust communication with a satellite constellation. Several lunar data relay satellites planned under the Artemis program and far-side lunar lander missions will further enhance connectivity. NASA and ESA are developing interoperable lunar communication networks through the LunarNet agreement, strengthening the system's reliability and reach. Final thoughts. The team has established costs for the lunar base, relying on Falcon Heavy and the Lunar Gateway Station. So I'm not sure how useful these estimates are. Their graph illustrates cost estimates over time. The projected cost for the first 15 years of operation is 120 billion euros, approximately 138 billion US dollars. To offset expenses, the plan proposes enabling tourism at the base, reducing transportation costs when Starship is commercially available, and selling propellants to lunar lander companies. For example, Blue Origin has expressed interest in purchasing lunar-derived hydrogen and oxygen for its Mark II lunar lander. Although SpaceX hasn't, it's worth noting that each Starship is capable of storing 1,000 tons of liquid oxygen. In conclusion, the plan outlines a permanent settlement for four astronauts at the lunar South Pole, near the rim of Der Galash crater, close to accessible water ice deposits. In-situ resource utilization will produce water for energy storage, plant cultivation, oxygen for life support, and propellants for lunar landers. A greenhouse module will grow food, decreasing reliance on Earth resupply missions. This design shares core elements with other lunar-based concepts, such as the Artemis Space Camp, which starts modestly with a single habitat module. The key difference lies in ambition. Is this plan overly ambitious, or does a permanent lunar base demand such bold thinking? Share your thoughts in the comments below. Thanks for watching. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. I recap the videos I posted this week, answer questions, respond to comments and chat messages, cover any missed news, and preview upcoming content. I'd love for you to join if you can. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.